Hello, dear student. I'm Shikha. Brought to you a new story from our course book, New Broadway. The name of the story is The Refugee. Refugee means those persons who are forced to leave their places where they are living because of some war, political or religious ill treatment, or because of some natural disaster. This short story describes the sad plight of Chinese peasants who were forced to leave their villages due to floods and starvation. Plight is called condition. Peasants means farmer. Floods is a condition of overflow of the water due to overflowing river, dam break, snow melt or heavy rainfall. And starvation means the pain caused by lack of food. So this story is about Chinese farmers and showing their condition because they had to leave their villages in which they were living because of the overflowing water and lack of food, and move to the city to suffer untold miseries and misfortunes. Miseries are the troubles and misfortunes means bad luck. Now, because of overflowing of the villages, all the farmers had to move towards a new city, and there they had to face so many troubles and bad luck. The writer's description of the refugees' hardship and sufferings is deeply touching. The description is called Explaining the Story. So writer has explained this story, and when we go through the story, you are going to feel so touched that as if the reality is going to be present about the pain and problems under which these refugees were going through. The writer of this story is Pearl S. Burke. She born in 1892 and died in 1973. She was an American novelist. Her best known novel is The Good Earth, that has come in 1931, for which she was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1938. She went to China to be a missionary and taught at Chinese universities. She worked for the promotion of a better understanding between the East and the West. So Pearl S. Burke, an American novelist, has written this beautiful story, and she was known for her novel The Good Earth, for which she was awarded the biggest Nobel Prize of Literature in 1938. She also worked as a teacher at Chinese University, and she worked really hard to promote better understanding between East and the West. Here is the glossary that will help you while explaining the chapter. Here the story starts. They walk through the new capital alien and from a far country, although their own lands were only a few hundred miles perhaps from this very street upon which they now walked. But to them, it was very far. Alien means when you are feeling yourself strange because you are a new person for that place. So all the villagers were feeling themselves as a stranger because now they were going ahead to a new city. And that city was not very far from their villages, but for them, the road on which they were walking right now and the road that will take them to a new city was really far. They who had been accustomed only to country roads and fields walked now along the proud street of the new capital. Accustomed means when you are in practice of something, and country roads and field means village roads and crop fields. So all the villagers were habitual of walking on the village mud road and in crop fields, but right now they all were walking on a broad street of a new capital city. Their feet treading upon the new concrete sidewalk. Treading upon means walking, and concrete sidewalk means cemented footpath. So all the villagers were walking on cemented footpath, and although the street was full of things they had never seen before, still they looked at nothing but passed as in a dream, seeing nothing. So when you are on the city road, you can imagine the condition of the city road. Means the city road was full of traffic, cars, buses, horns, vendors, means so much much noise and so much traffic was there, but all these villagers were looking as if nothing is going to be disturbed them. They were quietly walking on the footpath. There were several hundred of them passing at this moment. Hundred of the refugees were going on that road. If they did not look at anything nor at anyone, neither did any look at them. They were not looking at any kind of traffic on any people of that city, and the same from that side means the people of that city were not paying any attention to them. The city was full of refugees, many thousands of them, fed after a fashion, clothed somehow, sheltered in mats in great camps outside the city walls. Now the city was full with the refugees because they were thousands in number. Fed after a fashion means after a long duration, means after a long time they ate something, they hardly arranged cloths to cover themselves, and they took shelters in the big temporary camps that were held by the local government outside of the city wall. At any hour of day, lined of ragged men and women and a few children could be seen making their way towards the camp. Ragged means a rough condition. So any time of the day means in the morning, afternoon, evening, or even at the night time, the man and woman in rough condition wearing old and torn clothes with their children could be seen heading towards these camps, because these camps were the only place where they can find the shelter. And if any city dweller noticed them, it was to think with increased bitterness, more refugees, will there never be an end to them? Now, dweller is called the resident of that city, the people who are living in that city. So the people who were living in that city, whenever they noticed these refugees coming to their city, so a kind of hate and bitterness started coming in their heart, and they said that more refugees, how many will come? Means there is no end and of these refugees, and they will keep on coming in their cities. We will all starve trying to feed them even a little. Now the kind of thinking was coming in their mind that they all are going to faced with the lack of food because they have to share their food with these refugees. So are you understanding the situation, which kind of situation was there in the city? Means after the destruction of the villages, all the village peoples are forced to move their city. That's why now the city population suddenly increased with the with these refugees, and the people who were already living in that city, they started feeling a kind of hate and a type of bitterness for these refugees, because they have to compromise with these refugees by giving their space, giving their food, and they did not want to share all these things with these refugees. This bitterness, which is the bitterness of fear, made the small shopkeepers bawl out rudely to the many beggars who came hourly to beg at the doors. So there was a rudeness of fear in small shopkeepers, and they were scolding on many beggars because they were keep coming every hour to beg at their shop doors. And it made man ruthless in paying small fares to the rickshaw pullers, of which there were 10 times as many as could be used, because the refugees were trying to earn something thus. Now the refugees were part of that city, and they had to earn their livelihood by some means. So many of the refugees became rickshaw puller, and suddenly the number of rickshaw pullers in that city increased 10 times than usual. So people were not showing any kind of pity and compassion to these refugees, and they were not interested in giving them fare. With the city full of refugees, then begging at every door, swarming into every unskilled trade and service. Now the city was completely full with the refugees. They could be seen at every place of that city. They were begging at every door. Swarming means in a large group.
unskilled trade and services means if they are, whether they are trained or not, but they were trying to opt any kind of profession or service to earn their livelihood. So what they were coming in different type of profession and services in large group in that city, lying dead on the street on every frozen dawn. Why should one look at this fresh horde coming in now at twilight of winter's day? These refugees could be seen on the street in the very cold morning. Dawn is the time of early morning. So early morning, any of the refugees can be seen at any place on the street, lying down here and there. And winter season was going on. So nobody was interested in looking at this refugees. Horde means the crowd of the people. So refugees were coming in numbers, in crowd in that city, and now in that winter season, in that frozen condition, nobody was interested to take a look on these refugees. But these were now common man and woman. These people were not looked like common people. No riffraff from some community, always poor and easily starving in flood time. Riffraff means undesirable, something or someone that is not liked by anyone. So these people were not belonging to a community that is not liked by anyone, and these are not also like those poor peoples who are having nothing to eat during the flood time. No, these were men and women of which any nation might have been proud. These were the kind of people on which any nation might have been proud of having them as its resident. It could be seen they were all from one region, for they wore garments woven out of the same dark blue cotton stuff. If one could see, then he would say that all the people were belonging to the same community, because the garments that they were wearing was made of the same dark blue cotton fabric, plain and cut in an old-fashioned way, the sleeves long and the coats long and full. The cut of their garment were designed in old-fashioned way, and that were plain. They are having long sleeves, and the coat were long enough that it can cover the full length. The man wore a smoked apron. Smoked is a kind of decorative stitch, and apron is a garment that is worn in the front part of the body. So male members of this community used to be wear smoked aprons. So here writer is trying to give the description of the personality of these peoples, that these people were also leading a good lifestyle. They were having their own identity. They were having the sense of wearing clothes. But because of the hazardous condition that has come in their village, that forced them to migrate to this city. The smoking done in curious, intricate, beautiful design. Curious means a kind of thing that has desire to know about, and intricate means very fine. So the smoking that has been done on the aprons worn by the male members of that community were having very curious, very fine and beautiful design over them. The women had bands of the same plain blue stuff wrapped like kerchiefs about their heads. The women of that community were wearing the same blue color fabric and tied that around their heads like handkerchief. Both man and woman were tall and strong in frame, although the woman's feet were bound. Frame is called body structure. So all the men and women of that community were tall and well built in the body structure, though the women's were need a little force to keep their steps ahead. Every man and every lad bore a burden on his shoulder. All the male members of that community, lad is called a boy, so all the male members were bearing or taking a type of a weight on their shoulders. This burden was always bedding, quilts made of the blue cotton stuff and padded, and clothing clean and strongly made. This weight, they are having all the required things that is necessary to make the bed during the night times, and quilts that are used in the winter season, and these quilts are stuffed with the cotton stuff and well padded, and then they were covered with the clean cloth of the made of same blue cotton fabric, and that all were made very strongly. On top of every folded quilt with a bit of mat between was an iron cauldron. a cauldron is called very big vessel that is used to cook the food. So everybody was carrying a big vessel made of iron, and that was capped on the folded quilt, and between this quilt and cauldron there were some mat that were capped. These cauldrons had doubtless been taken from the earthen ovens of the village when the people saw the time had come when they must move. Ovens means as we are having electric ovens in our home, OTG and microwave, same as they are having the ovens made of mud in the villages. And these earthen ovens are filled with the coal and pieces of the wood, and then they fired, and then on these earthen ovens big vessels are kept, and then the food is cooked. So all the villagers might have understood that during this flood time they have to be migrated from their village. That's why everybody has made mind and took this big vessels with them. But in no basket was there a vestige of food, nor was there a trace of food having been cooked in them recently. Vestige is called sign. Means after everybody was having a big vessel that is used to cook the food, but after looking on these vessels, nobody can say that these vessels are having any kind of aroma, any kind of sign of having any food grains in that, because so many days has passed, they have nothing to eat, they have nothing to cook them. That's why no cauldron was giving a sign that recently somebody has cooked anything in them. So here the complete description of all the stuffs that is carried by the people of that community to this city was given by the writer.
This lack of food was confirmed when one looked closely into the faces of the people. Food makes you healthy, but if you have not taken anything for so many days, then how can you see happiness and shine on your face? The same thing is described here, that if one looked into the faces of these peoples, then he realized that they had not taken a single grain of food for so many days. In the first glance, in the twilight, they seemed well enough, but when one looked more closely, one saw they were the faces of people starving and moving now in despair to a last hope. Glance means look. So at first glance, in the dim light, they seemed well enough because they were having well-built body structure. But when you looked more closely into their faces, then you could felt that yes, these peoples were dying of starvation, of lack of food, and now they all were moving towards a despair situation, towards a sad situation, and only this city had remained their last hope. They saw nothing of the strange sight of a new city because they were too near death to see anything. Now think about a person who spent whole life in village, and first time he came to the city, then there could be so many things for that person to see, to be curious about. But these peoples were least bothered to see anything, to know about anything, because they were very close to their death because of the starving situation. No new sight could move their curiosity. They were not interested in looking at any new or any happy sight. They were men and women who had stayed by their land until starvation drove them forth. They were men and women belonging to that community that used to do farming, that used to grow their own crop, that used to lead their respectful life. But the starving situation, the flooded situation forced them to migrate from their village to this city. Thus they passed unseeing, silent, alien, as those who know themselves dying are alien to the living. That's why all the refugees who were walking on the road, they were walking without looking anything, without saying any word, and making themselves strangers for the people of that city as well as for the life. And they were very close to death. Now see how beautifully the writer has described this condition in the last line of the
this paragraph, as those who know themselves dying are alien to the living. Means these peoples were well known about this fact that they were about to die. Means they were very well known to that, but they were a stranger for the life. So in this paragraph, writer tried to describe the pathetic, the sad condition of those peoples who once led their life in a respectable manner, but now they are forced to live their life in this pathetic condition with their family because of the migration, migrating situation that occurred due to starvation. The last one of this long procession of silent man and woman was a little wizened old man. Procession mean group of people who walk together in a line. In Hindi it is called jaloos, and wizened means wrinkled. So on that road there was a group of people walks along the road silently, including man and woman, and in that line the last one was a wrinkled old man. Even he carried a load of two baskets slung on a pole on his shoulder, the same load of a folded quilt and the cauldron. He was also carrying the same weight as the weight was carried by the other persons, and that was hung on a pole, and that pole he was carrying on his shoulder. One basket was filled with the quilt and one basket was having a big vessel. But there was only one cauldron, but he was taking only one big vessel. In the other basket it seemed there was but a quilt, extremely ragged and patched, but clean still. In other basket there was only one quilt capped, and that was extremely ragged, is called old. That quilt was looking very old and patched. Patched means when a cloth is torn, and to mend that cloth another piece of the fabric is stitched at that part, and that became a patched. So a number of patch can be seen on that old quilt. So the fabric was old, but still that was clean. Although the load was light, it was too much for the old man. That load was not very heavy, but for that old man that was really heavy. It was evident that in usual times he would be beyond the age of work, and was perhaps unaccustomed to such labor in recent years. After looking at that old man, one could say that that person was not in the age of doing hard work, but because of some situation, circumstances in last some years, he became habitual of doing hard work. His breath whistled as he staggered along, and he strained his eyes to watch those who were ahead of him, lest he be left behind. Whistled means when loud sound started coming from your breathing, and staggered means to put unsteady steps on the road, and strained means nervousness. So after looking at that old man, one can listen to the whistling sound that was coming from his breathing, and he was not walking properly. He was walking with unsteady steps, and it was looking as he was about to fall down. And he was looking on the group of people who were going ahead with a nervousness in his eyes, because he was the only person who was left behind in that line. And his old wrinkled face was sat in a sort of gasping agony. Gasping means panting or breathing very fast, and agony means pain. So finding himself alone, he sat aside on the road because he was not able to take that weight again and to walk properly with that group of people. So he sat aside on the road, and a kind of pain could be seen on his wrinkled face, and he was breathing very fast. Till now, writer has described about the group of people, about the condition of refugees, the situation of village, the scene of city. But in this paragraph, writer introduced with the character of this story, and that was an old man. Suddenly he could go no more. Now old man was not having courage to move on. He set his burden down with great gentleness and sank upon the ground, his head sunk between his knees, his eyes closed, panting desperately. He kept the weight aside of the road with great gentleness and he fell down on the ground. His hand hung between his knees, his eyes were closed and he was breathing badly. Starved as he was, a little blood rose in dark patches on his cheeks. He was very hungry. His cheeks became very dry. Dark patches could be seen on his cheeks, and because of this dryness, a little blood rose out from his cheeks. A ragged vendor selling hot noodles sat his stand near and shouted his strait cry as the light from the stand fell on the old man's drooping figure. Drooping figure means when the body bent due to old age. So an old vendor, an old seller of the hot noodles, sat his stand near the old man, and the light was coming from the electric pole of the road on the weakened figure of that old man. So that old man was visible in that light. A man passing stopped and muttered, looking at him. A man was passing by on that road. He took a look on that old man and he spoke slowly. I swear I can give no more this day if I am to feed my own even nothing but noodles. But there is this old man. He was saying that he cannot give more than this much to this old man because he had to feed himself also, not from anything but just from the noodles. Well, I'll give him a bit of the silver I earn today against tomorrow and trust to tomorrow again. Now, whatever earning he was having for the day, that silver coin, he wanted to give that money to that old man, and he was having trust that he is going to earn that money again tomorrow. If my own old father had been alive, I would have given it to him. He was saying that instead of this old man, if his own father had been alive, then he would have given this money to his father. But this time, this money was very much needed by that old man, because after seeing the condition of that old man, anybody could say that this man really need to eat something. So here the kindness of a strange man was showing that he was passing on the road. He saw that old man and he understood the condition, that how hungry that old man was, and whatever the money he earned that day, he wanted to give that money to that old person so that that old person could eat something. He fumbled in his clothes and brought out of his wrecked girdle a bit of silver coin. Fumbled means when you are handle of finding something without paying much attention, and wrecked girdle means the old waist belt. So that man was trying to find something without paying much attention in his clothes, and from his waist belt he took out a bit of silver coin. And after some time, after a moment's hesitation and muttering, he added to it a copper penny. And after some time, with some hesitation and with some mumbling, he added a copper coin in the silver coin. So now that man wanted to give a silver as well as a copper coin to that old man. Dear old father, he said with a sort of bitter heartiness, let me see you eat noodles. And then that man said to that old man with a little kind bitterness of his heart that let me see means I am here and I am looking at you, that are you eating these noodles or not. The old man lifted his head slowly. When he saw the silver, he would not put out his hand, and he said, the old man looked at him slowly, and after looking at the silver coin, he was not able to take his hand out to take that coin, and that's why that old man did not want to take that coin from that person. Sir, I did not beg of you, sir. That old man was saying to that man that he is not begging of him. Sir, we have good land and we have never been starving like this before having such good land. old man was talking about his story that he was also having a good farming land, but this starving situation he had seen never before in his life. But this year the river rose and man is starved even on good land at such times. But this year the river that is flowing in their villages that overflow due to heavy rain, and there was a starving situation. They lost their good land, the village was destroyed, and everybody had to face a situation where they were left with no food. Sir, we don't even have seed left and we have eaten our seeds. We have not left with a single seed with us, and because of the scarcity of the food, we had eaten our seed. I told them we cannot eat the seed, but they were young and hungry and they ate it. Old man was saying that to the children, to the young person of my family and the villagers, I told them don't eat the seed because they are going to help us in the future. But nobody listened to me. They were so hungry and no food was remained there. So they all have eaten all the seed. Here the old man was trying to make it clear that he was not a beggar. If that man was giving him a silver or a copper coin after understanding him as a beggar, so that man was wanted to make him clear that he was not a beggar. He was also belonging to a good family. He was a farmer having his own land, but because of the flood, the starving situation, they all had to migrate from their village towards this city. "Take it," said the man, and he dropped the money into the old man's smoked apron and went on his way sighing. But that man was not listening anything, and with the force that man put that silver and copper coin in the pocket of the apron that he was worn by that old man, and he went away on his way. Then the vendor prepared his bowl of noodles and called out, "How many will you eat, old man?" Now the shopkeeper who was standing there with his stand of hot noodles, he was listening to all the conversation. So he asked to that old man that how many noodles bowl he would like to eat. Then was the old man stirred. Stirred is called moved. That old man moved. He felt eagerly in his apron, and when he saw the two coins there, the one copper and the other silver, he said, "One small bowl is enough." Then he found with eagerness in his apron two coins. One was of copper, one was of silver. Then he said to the hot noodles vendor that one small bowl of the noodles would be enough for me. "Do you want to eat only one small bowl then?" asked the vendor astonished. The vendor asked with wonder that "You want only one small bowl of noodles?" "It is not for me," the old man answered. The old man said that "This bowl of noodle is not for me." The vendor stared astonished, but being a simple man, he said no more but prepared the bowl, and when it was finished, he called out, "Here it is," and he waited to see who would eat it. The vendor was stared is called to look, astonished is called with wonder. The vendor was looking at him with wonder, but he said nothing, and he started preparing one bowl of noodle. And when it is finished, he called out that "Please take your noodles," and he waited to see that to whom the old man is going to feed those noodles. Then the old man rose with a great effort and took the bowl between his shaking hands and went to the other basket. That old man rose with great effort, took the bowl of noodles in his shaking hand and went to the other basket. There, while the vendor watched, the old man pulled aside the quilt until one could see the shrunken face of a small boy lying with his eyes fast closed. The vendor was watching everything very carefully. That old man pulled the quilt that was kept in the other basket aside, and then one could see that there was lying a small boy. His face was very small and his eyes were closed very tightly. One would have said the child was dead, except that when the old man lifted his head so his mouth could touch the edge of the little bowl, he began to swallow feebly until the hot mixture was
finished. Feebly means without strength. So if one would have take a look of that basket of that boy, then he would definitely say that this boy is dead. But when the old man lifted the head of that boy so that his mouth could touch the edge of that little boy and he could eat that, then he started swallowing it. Means the child was so weak that he was not able to chew the mixture. So when we eat something without chewing it, this is called swallowing. So that child started swallowing the mixture of that bowl until it was finished. So now it was clear that that old man bought one small bowl of noodles not for himself but for the child that was lying down in the other basket of that weight was carrying by that old man.
The old man kept murmuring to him, "They're my heart, they're my child." When the little boy was eating the mixture, old man was continuously saying, "They're my heart, they're my child." "Your grandson," said the vendor. The vendor asked, "Is this your grandson?" "Yes," said the old man. "The son of my only son." He was the son of his only son. "Both my son and his wife were drowned as they worked on a land when the dikes broke." Dikes is a thick wall that is built in the lower land area to stop the flooded water. So the man was saying that his son and his daughter-in-law both were working in the land, and at the same time, due to the heavy force of the flood water, the dikes broke and they both were drowned and dead. He covered the child tenderly and then is squatting on his haunches. Squatting on his haunches means to sit on the heels by keeping the knees towards up. So again he softly covered the child and then he sat aside. He ran his tongue carefully around the little bowl and removed the last trace of the food. Some traces of the foods were remained in the bowl. So he licked the bowl, little bowl, very carefully. Then, as though he had been fed, he handed the bowl back to the vendor. It was looking as if he had eaten the food, and after eating that food, he gave that bowl back to the vendor. "But you have the silver bit," cried the ragged vendor, yet more astonished when he saw the old man ordered no more. "But you are having a silver penny," cried the old vendor, and he was wondered because that old man was not ordering one more bowl of the noodles for himself. The old man shook his head. "That is for seed," he replied. That old man looked at the vendor and replied that he wanted to keep this penny to buy more seed. "As soon as I saw it, I knew I would buy seed with it. When I got this silver coin, at the same time I thought that I'm going to buy seed with this silver coin. They ate up all the seed, and with what shall the land be sown again? All the seeds have finished, all the seeds are eaten by all the youngers and the children. Now we have left with no seed. So how can we grow the crop again? How can we sow the seed in the land again? So that's why I want to keep this silver coin to buy more seed for my land. If I were not so poor myself," said the vender, "I might have even given you a bowl, but to give something to a man who has a bit of silver," he shook his head puzzled. That vendor said that "I myself a poor person, otherwise I might have given you an extra bowl of the noodles for yourself, but I have a confusion and a little wonder to give a extra bowl of noodles without any rupees to a person who is already having a silver penny." "I do not ask you, brother," said the old man. The old man said to vendor, "I do not ask you to give me an extra bowl of noodles for me. Well, I know you cannot understand. You cannot understand what I am trying to say. But if you had land, you would know it must be put to seed again, or there will be starvation yet another year. You are not having land, but if you would have been a land, only then you would know that it is very required to sow the seed in the land so that we can grow the crop again. Otherwise, the starving situation that we are facing right now, the same starving situation is followed another year. The best I can do for this grandson of mine is to buy a little seed for the land. I cannot do anything for my grandson, but the best thing that I can do for him is to buy little seed so that I will be able to grow the crop on that land again to avoid this starvation situation. Yes, even though I die, others must plant it, the land must be put to seed. If I die, but the other villagers were there who will plant this seed in the land, and the land must be put to seed to grow the crop again. He took up his load again, his old legs trembling and straining his eyes down the long straight street he staggered on. After saying this to Vendor, he slowly rose and then lifted that weight and started moving with his shaking legs and with a type of nervousness in his eyes. He was looking the long straight street on which he has to walk, and he started walking with his unsteady step to a never-ending road. Here this story ends with the message that we should never lose our hope in the most negative situation. As we start the story from the beginning, a type of negative sadness and pathetic description is being given, but a ray of the hope has been given by this old man. And this old man was trying to say that even in the opposite condition, we should not lose hope and find a kind of positivity in a negative situation. With this, I end my video here. We'll meet again.